Hi, this is Michael Megali and Manos Brilakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting case 143 for the manual of CTO interventions. This is a case illustrating a potential challenge when crossing previous stents, which is sub-stent crossing, and how to address it. The patient presented with non-ST elevation myocardial infarction. He had known severe three-vessel coronary disease and had stents in the LAD and the circumflex, as well as multiple comorbidities. Coronary angiography demonstrated occlusion of the LAD. There was also occlusion of the obtuse marginal at the site of the previous stent. There was also potentially a filling defect in the LAD, suggesting that maybe the occlusion in the LAD was not chronic, but was potentially the culprit for the non-ST elevation myocardial infarction. There was also an occlusion of the right coronary artery. What is the next step? Essentially, this is a patient with three-vessel chronic total occlusions, and in patients like this, coronary bypass graft surgery might be the better way to go, especially given the failure of both stents in the LAD and the obtuse marginal branch. However, the patient was turned down for coronary bypass graft surgery and was referred instead for PCI of the LAD. There is a well-defined proximal cap. Once again, there's a filling defect suggesting that this may not be a CTO, but actually an acute occlusion. The length of the in-stent occlusion is about 30 millimeters. Distal vessel is diffusely diseased, but is filling through ipsilateral collaterals. However, those collaterals do not seem to be appropriate for the retrograde approach. Therefore, the plan was to attempt undergrade wiring, followed by undergrade dissection and reentry. A turnpike microcatheter was advanced to the proximal cap, and then multiple wires were used. There was no success with the Samurai RC and the fighter. However, a pilot 200 initially went under the stent, but then was redirected and eventually crossed into the distal true lumen, as confirmed by this ipsilateral injection. The problem, however, is that a 1-5 balloon and a threader would not cross through the mid-LAD stent, despite using a guideliner. So this is a balloon uncrossable lesion, and this is a suggested algorithm with a small balloon first, following by more support, typically with a guide extension, then microcatheters, laser, atherectomy, subintimal techniques. In this particular case, the reason for the failure to cross is likely the wire going under the stent struts, which then creates resistance to equipment advancement. Nevertheless, we did not want to lose our distal wire position. Therefore, a 1.0 by 15 millimeter Sapphire Pro balloon, which is the lowest profile balloon available currently in the US, was used, and that could cross through the mid-LAD stent. Then there was dilatation, followed by a 2.0 millimeter balloon that then allowed an IVUS catheter to get through. And IVUS was very informative, showing two things. The first is that distally there is stent under expansion. There are two layers of stent, which is poorly expanded. But then as we go more proximally, we now have the wire being outside the stent. Here is the stent. Essentially, the wire crossed besides or under the stent struts, and then the balloon actually crossed the previously placed stent. So this was the reason for the resistance to equipment advancement, which is wire going under the stent struts. And then as we go further, more proximal in the vessel, now we have the stent being inside the wire. So essentially, our wire went through the stent, outside the stent, and again through the stent. So two problems. One was the balloon uncrossable. The second was how to dilate the previously placed underexpanded stent. And typically, this is achieved first with high pressure inflations of non-compliant balloons or plaque modification balloons. If this does not work, one can use laser and or atherectomy, followed by subintimal lesion crossing. The intravascular lithotripsy balloons are a very promising modality for in-stent underexpansion. In this case, after balloon inflation, there was occlusion of a septal branch that caused chest discomfort and ST segment changes, and that is why thrombectomy was done, restoring flow into that septal branch. Then multiple high-pressure balloon inflations were performed with 3.0 and 3.5 millimeter NC balloons, and actually these were successful in expanding the previously placed stents. There was one additional stent placed more proximally, followed by high pressure balloon inflation throughout the LAD stents, and this actually was successful in expanding the stents as confirmed with intravascular ultrasound. So high pressure balloon inflations in our case were successful in expanding. Had they not been successful, laser with contrast would likely have been the next step. And this was the final result with good TIMI-3 flow into the LAD and plan for staged procedure for the right coronary artery as well as the circumflex. So in summary, if there is resistance in crossing through a previous stent after wiring, this could be due to substent wire course, and the way to correct this might be to wire with another wire or potentially wire with a knuckle guide wire, which is less likely to go under the stent struts. And then if that's not feasible, as in our case in which we did not want to lose the wire position, an alternative way is to just crush that portion of the stent and then use another stent to restore undergrade flow. This case illustrates the importance of having algorithms for potential challenges, which were the difficulty advancing a balloon and also the difficulty in dilating a previously placed stent. And finally, in cases of stent problems, in this case this was stent thrombosis and stent restenosis, intravascular imaging is critical to ensure that an excellent final result is achieved to minimize the risk of recurrent stent failure. Thank you.